a journey, what a season, hey? Oh, what nut stuff is out there in the world, hey? Let me just, so many people have asked me, yes, we've had it. Do you know God is the author and the finisher of medicine? Yeah. Do you know God works through medicine? Yeah. Do you know it's not second-class healing? Do you know we see more miracles in hospital than some of you see a year? It sounds like you don't believe me. Do you know how many miracles happen in a hospital on a daily basis? Through believing doctors and nurses and personnel and physios and... So, thank you. Thank you so many over this season. Sent me personal messages and prayers. We were, you know, I think somehow the world got a little bit, got the medicine and the government all mixed up, you know, like the stupid stuff the government was doing was kind of like the medical people's fault. Well, we were just trying to heal as many people as we can. So it was a very interesting journey. But for many people, if you speak to psychologists, if you speak to economists, if you speak to educationalists, what do you call people? Yeah, it does. Hey, good to see you, Bill. Yeah, you hear some of the testimony of the story I want to share. So, you know, so we go through things in life, and then one of the best things I've ever heard is find your story in the Bible. Did you know that this pandemic story is in the Bible? I'm going to show you. Through Dr. Luke. In, you know, I just have to be there with my medical people. Dr. Luke is giving us one of the most comprehensive, detailed stories on how to handle a world pandemic. Believe it or not. So I want you to find your story in this, because you know what? God has not changed his plans. We're talking about a new normal, but you know what? No, God's not thrown. God's not changed the plans he has for you. It's still the same. He's still going to establish what he wanted to establish in your personal life, in the life of Journey of Grace, in our city, in our country. He's not thrown by this. So I want to jump right in. I'm going to read a lot of Bible today. I had to print it out because it's kind of hard with a mic and a Bible in my hand. So for those of you that haven't gone through your Bible reading this year, I'm going to get you a little bit more up to speed. So you got to fasten your seatbelts here. And, you know, we're a Bible-believing, Holy Spirit, glory-manifesting, honey-dripping church. Okay? Okay, so I've got good news for you. So just put out your hands. More, Lord. Oh, more, Lord. Just say, don't miss the revival in Malta. Oh, Lord. But you might have to be shipwrecked first. But hey, come on, let's go. Okay. Acts 27. When it was decided that we would sail for Italy. Okay. Who's been through lockdown? Sail for Italy brings up, for me, Venice, Amalfi Coast, vineyards in Tuscany. Yes, let's go to Italy. Paul and some other prisoners. Okay. Woo, okay, shift here. It's not a Mediterranean cruise. This is a prisoner. Were handed over to a centurion named Julius, who belonged to the imperial regiment. We boarded a ship from Adramyttium about to sail for ports along the coast of the province of Asia, and we put out to sea. Aristarchus, they could have just said Yanni, a Macedonian from Thessalonica was with us. Okay, let's get some background here. Paul, we now realize, is a prisoner. The background here is you can go read in Acts 23, 24, 25, 26. Paul was on his missionary journeys. And a lot of these churches was wanted to send offering to the church in Jerusalem that was going through a great hardship, great lack. And they told Paul, do not go back. They are going to kill you. You cannot go back to Jerusalem. But like you know, Paul had a very big heart for the church of Jerusalem because he first persecuted them. And he said he wants to go back. So what they said happened. They literally, 40 men one night, wanted to kill Paul. They actually fasted that they're going to find him and kill him. And the only way Paul was saved from literally his arms and limbs being ripping apart was by the Roman soldiers. And then Paul, being a Roman citizen, could say he wanted to see Caesar. And it's basically, if you read through that, it's very much the story of Jesus. It was the Pharisees and the Sadducees, the religious leaders of that day, that rose up against Paul, and the Romans stepped in. So then Paul was in a prison or held captive in Caesarea for 2 years. And I just want to read Acts 23:11. The next night the Lord came and stood by Paul. He said, be brave. And we heard that a lot of times. You have told people in Jerusalem about me. You must do the same in Rome. That was the word of the Lord for Paul. For 2 years, he was waiting to go to Rome. That was the plan of his life. That was the purpose of his life. That is what God wanted him to do, to go to Rome, because he knew if he could preach the gospel in Rome, from Rome, the gospel would go to the known world as they knew at that time, because it was the Roman Empire. So Paul, being in the will of God, in the plan of God, in the purpose of God, how was he going to get to Rome? By being a prisoner. He did not see that coming. He did not see that coming. God, regardless of your circumstances, God has not changed his plan for your life. It might be that he's taking you a different way than you thought he's going to take you. And this is very pertinent for this season. Sometimes you might think he's changed his mind. He has not changed his mind. What he's promised you, he has not changed his mind. The next day we landed at Sidon, and Julius, in kindness to Paul, allowed him to go to his friends so they might provide for his needs. From there we put out to sea again and passed to the lee of Cyprus because the winds were against us. Paul was on track to his destiny, the first steps of going to Rome. Right at the onset, the winds were against us. March 2020. When we sailed across the open sea of the coast of two names, we landed in Myria and Lycia. There the centurion found an Alexandrian ship for Italy. Hey, we're back on track, and put us on board. We made slow headway for many days and had difficulty. So we started. The winds were against us. A little step further, now we have difficulty. April 2020. After much time had been lost and sailing had already become dangerous, because by now it was after the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement is Yom Kippur. That is September. Much time has been lost. Now we March, April, May, June, July, August, September. Much time has been lost. For many of us, last year feels like time has been lost. It wasn't what I planned. It wasn't what I envisioned for 2020. I had plans for my business. I had plans for my career. There were things that I wanted to do, things I believed God called me to do. And now I could feel first the winds against me. Now it's downright dangerous. Men, I can see that our voyage is going to be disastrous and bring great loss to ship and cargo and to our own lives always. But the centurion, instead of listening to what Paul said, followed the advice of the pilot and the owner of the ship. Since the harbor was unsuitable to winter, the majority decided that we should sail on, hoping to reach Phoenix and winter there. This was a harbor in Crete facing both southwest and northwest. It's incredible detail. I mean, you can go into all of this, but this will take years. The storm. When a gentle south wind began to blow, they saw the opportunity, so they weighed anchor and sailed along the shore of Crete. Before very long, a wind of hurricane force. Okay? So the winds were against us. Then there was difficulty. Then much time lost. Then we're facing a hurricane. How many of you will still feel that God's really got your back for your plan and purpose facing a hurricane? And if you go read the Aegean Sea, that time of year gets hurricanes. The ship was caught by a storm and could not head into the wind, so we gave way to it and were driven along. If you speak to many people, and maybe many of you have felt it as well, no one saw what the world was going to face last year. Many feel that you were just driven along. Just driven along. You couldn't, things that you wanted to do, things that you wanted to decide, you couldn't. The government was telling you what you can and cannot do. So you just driven along. The plans you had, the purposes you had, the things you thought you were going to accomplish, you now just being driven along. We were hardly able to make the lifeboat secure, so the men hoisted it aboard. They passed ropes under the ship itself to hold it together because they were afraid they would run aground on the sandbars of Citrus. They lowered the sea anchor and let the ship be driven along. We took a violent battering from the storm that the next day they began to throw the cargo overboard. On the third day, they threw the ship's tackle overboard with their own hands. With neither sun nor stars appeared for many days, and the storm continued raising, they finally gave up all hope. Okay, now we are, where are we now? December, January 21. They had to throw the cargo overboard. What is a ship's cargo? A ship's cargo is its provision. It's provision. Because where they come in the ports, they sell. They had to throw some of their provision overboard. Maybe some of you have gone through losing a job. Your provision has been taken away from you. Not with your, with any of your doing. You're struggling financially. You had goals. Everything was going well. You had to throw your cargo overboard. After many days in the storm, they gave up hope. So the encouraging thing is Paul wasn't immune to it. He felt the nausea of the seasickness, of thinking that this ship is going to be shipwrecked. He was in the midst with them. He could identify with what's going on. That's why I'm saying Paul knows what we're going through. Under the sun, no stars appeared for many days. What did they use the sun and the moon for during those days? Navigate. So if there's no moon or no sun, they cannot navigate. How many of you have felt through this season, wow, where's God? I can't see him. I can't find him. I don't know where I am. I can't get my course. I mean, for us, I have to be honest, in the medical field, for me, it was such a challenging season of how to navigate, how to, you know, on the one side, we have my physios were the main physios in one of the private hospitals. We had a high care and an ICU full, 24 patients, and ventilators at its max. How do you navigate? Where's God in this? After they had gone time without food, Paul stood up before them and said, men, You should have taken my advice. Then you would have spared yourselves this damage and loss. But now I urge you to keep up your courage, because not one of you will be lost. Only the ship will be destroyed. That is the word of the Lord to us. Keep up our courage. Keep up our courage. Your purpose is not destroyed. But maybe there are some ships that need to be destroyed. Maybe our confidence was more in the ship than the steerer of the ship. And this is really a season where we can be brought back to what is important. What is important in life? What is it, the intimacy we have with Jesus, with God? All the other stuff, does that really matter? It's brought us back to family, relationships. What matters in life? Maybe some ships need to run aground. Last night, an angel of the Lord to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me and said, "Do not be afraid. You must stand trial before Caesar in Rome." There is it again, the plan and the purpose of God. What has God spoken to you? What is the prophetic word over your life? What is the dream and the vision you have for your life? It must. God will fulfill it. Regardless of whatever ships run aground around you. So keep up your courage, men, for I have faith in God that it will happen, just as he told me. Nevertheless, we must run aground on some island. What does Paul do in the midst of the storm? He witnesses. Praise party. They're in the midst of the storm. Like I said, he wasn't immune to the seasickness. He was in a hurricane on a wooden vessel, not Mediterranean cruise ship, wooden vessel. What does he say? Points everyone, the angel of the Lord. The Lord says. This is what the Lord says. In the midst of the storm, we have to find our voice to say, this is what the Lord says. This is what the Lord says. This is the testimony of the Lord. What is your must from God? Just take a moment. What is that must that maybe some of us have given hope? I mean, for me, I had an idea where I was going. It kind of did get a little bit sidetracked, you know, with everything that was piled up on us. And it's just more responsibility, more stress, more this, more that. Help here. You know, and you can kind of like, am I going this way or that way? In an attempt to escape from the ship, the sailors let the lifeboat down into the sea, pretending they were going to lower some anchors from the bow. Then Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay with the ship, you cannot be saved." Some of you want to jump ship, whether that's in your marriage, whether that's in life, whether that's in hope, stay on the ship is the word of the Lord. And I really feel someone online, you've given up on life itself. You've given up on life itself. Right now, the Lord says, don't despair. Don't despair. I am with you. I am with you. For the last 14 days, he said, you have constant suspense and have gone without food. You haven't eaten anything. Now I urge you to take some food. You need it to survive. Not one of you will lose a single hair from his head. After he said this, he took some bread and gave thanks to God in front of them. Communion, the power of communion. That is a message in itself. There were 276 of us on board. Through a hurricane, in a wooden ship, cargo overboard, anchor overboard, everything overboard, not one was lost. When daylight came, they did not recognize the land, but they saw a bay with a sandy beach where they decided to run the ship aground if they could. Cutting loose the anchors, they let them in the sea and at the same time untied the ropes that held the rudder. Then they hoisted the foresail to the wind and made for the beach, but the ship struck a sandbar and ran aground. Broken in pieces. Then the soldiers wanted to kill everyone. The centurion, looking after Paul, said, "No, don't do it." He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and get to land. The rest were to get there on planks or on other pieces of the ship. And this way, everyone reached land safely. Do you know why I'm laughing? I mean, some of us, we April 2021, we just holding on to our plank here. I mean, it's just get me to shore, you know. It's like none of this, Michael rowed the boat ashore. Hello. I mean, you're just holding onto your plank. I mean, it's just, let me just get to shore, you know. I've had winds, difficulty, hurricane, shipwreck, May 2021. I still have my blank. Once safely on shore, we found out that the island was called Malta. They didn't even know where they were. I mean, how many of you feel like this? You know, it's like, I didn't even know where I am now, May 2021. Some people say it feels like it must be 1 January because, like, the whole year's like, I mean, they didn't even know where they were. But that didn't matter because Paul was on the way to Rome. So regardless of how you're feeling right now, if you've been storm-tossed and things haven't worked out like they were supposed to work out, and you're just holding onto your one little plank to get to shore, you're on your way to Rome. You know what? Don't despise Malta. Because I've got more good news for you. Don't despise Malta. Who of you ever knew Malta existed, by the way? Okay. The islanders showed us unusual kindness. They built a fire and welcomed us all because it was raining and cold. I mean, you've just made the shore with your plank. And now it's raining and it's cold. You think your circumstances are hard, eh? I mean, gosh, just find some encouragement here. Paul gathered a pile of brushwood, and as he put it on the fire, a viper, driven out by the heat, fastened itself onto his hand. I mean, yeah. Paul has just reached the shore on his plank. It's cold. He thought he's going to be a servant and help and a viper. And it says it fastens to its hand. So not just like pricky. I mean, it gets its like fangs. Is it fangs? Fangs in there, man. You know, and I mean... The islanders saw the snake hanging from his hand. They said to each other, "This man must be a murderer. For though he escaped from the sea, the goddess Justice had not allowed him to live." I mean, you know, maybe some of you're going through stuff and people are pointing fingers. Surely God is judging you. Maybe some sin in your life. Huh? How's the crowds? The crowds love to do that. Paul shook the snake off into the fire and suffered no ill effects. The people expected him to swell up or suddenly fall dead. I mean, the Paul that just saved there with his word, now they're waiting for him to die. But after waiting a long time and seeing nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and said he must be a god. Oh. God's question to us is, what must we shake off? What do we have to shake off? Is it disappointment? Is it hurt? Is it resentment? Is it anger? I mean, the storm couldn't get you, the hurricane couldn't get you, the shipwreck couldn't get you. Don't let the bite of the viper get you. Shake it off. Shake it off. Some of us feel like we don't even have the energy at the moment to shake anything off. Come on, be encouraged. The same people that when Jesus walked in, Hosanna, Hosanna, the same people the next day crucify him. It's the same happening here. He must be a God. Shake it off. There was an estate nearby that belonged to Publius, the chief official of the island. He welcomed us to his home and showed us generous hospitality for 3 days. His father was sick in bed, suffering from fever and dysentery. Paul went in to see him. After prayer, placed his hands on him and healed him. When this had happened, the rest of the sick on the island came and were cured. They had revival on the island. So maybe God is not taking you the way that you thought he was going to take you. But don't miss the revival. Don't miss what he's got for you. He hasn't changed his plan. You are going to Rome, baby. Rome. Nothing has changed his plan. But you know, there are things on the way. There are things on the way for you. There are people on the way that needs to be touched. There are people on the way that needs to know the good news. They honored us in many ways. And when we were ready to sail, don't miss this, they furnished us with the supplies we needed. Whatever the enemy has stolen from you, God will restore. If you have lost a job in the season, God is going to restore that. If your finances have come under attack, God will restore it from sources that you do not even see coming. You don't see it coming. God is in the business of restoring. They got the cargo that was thrown overboard. Everything. Everything they were supplied with. God will do anything to get supplies to you. Anything. Don't give up hope. I know the economy is saying this and the economists are saying that and this one is saying this and who knows if there's a third, a fourth, a fifth wave and if it's going to die and whatever. But you know what? God is in the business of restoring. Your latter rains will be more than your former rains. There's breakthrough in this house. There's breakthrough in finances. In Jesus' name. The moral of the story. What is the promise and the purpose and the plan and the provision and the dreams that God has placed in your heart that maybe if you've seen this season, I just cannot see it. Maybe you feel like it's been stolen, whether it's in emotions even. I mean, this season has pulled on emotions, on soul, like never before, on marriages, on relationships. You know, there's a quote from one of my favorite movies, Seabiscuit, and it says, you'll only know how high you are until you are called to rise. And in this season, so many of us have been called to rise constantly. And that can weigh on you. But you know, even though you are just holding onto your plank, revival. Don't miss the revival in Malta. Don't miss the provision. Don't miss your plan and purpose. You are going to Rome. And Paul got to Rome. And I mean, some of what we're living here is because of the faithful people witnessing in Rome for it to go to the ends of the earth, the message, the ends of the earth. So maybe you didn't quite envision, I'm going to get there, number one as a prisoner, and number two as shipwrecked. God has not changed his plans. He's not changed his plans. Good Friday. Now I'm back to Jesus. Why do they call it Good Friday? Have you ever thought? We call it Good Friday. Why? I mean, if you look at the circumstances of Good Friday, it doesn't feel too good. I mean, a crucifixion is one of the worst, most horrific things. Saturday. Good Friday, Saturday. Peter is asleep. Mary is crying. Hope is lost. Death has won. Judas has betrayed him. Satan is laughing. Jesus is buried. A soldier stands guard. A rock is rolled into place. But, why is Good Friday Good Friday? Because Sunday is coming. Sunday is coming. We have the luxury of hindsight. That's why we can say Good Friday. Maybe you feel like you're finding yourself on Friday at the moment, or even Saturday. You're delusioned. But, Sunday is coming. All your hopes, all your dreams, God will restore it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, you will get to Rome. Amen. Let's stand. I just want to open up the altar. If this has been a tough season for you, if you've had things lost, if you felt shipwrecked, maybe you still feel you in the shipwreck. Maybe you with your plank just trying to get to shore. Please come forward, because you know there's hope. Be encouraged. God has not forgotten you. God has not forgotten you. And there's something so glorious in your calling. And maybe we just needed to be reminded of it, because the world is throwing so many things at us in this season. I mean, you don't know if you must spray your left foot, right foot, hand, mouth, head, whatever. God has not forgotten you, and He wants to restore. And there are things that some of us have to shake off. You know, maybe if you felt despair or depression, you know, come for prayer. Come for prayer. Maybe these things we put our trust in, that ship needs to run aground, because it's God is the author and the finisher of our faith. It's Christ in us, the hope and glory. Maybe you just need some encouragement today. Please come to the front. Amen. In Jesus' name, see you in Rome.